Our Environmental Services Division accomplished a great deal in 2020. Still, our focus later in the year turned to the wildfires and how to help the region deal with this disaster. As of November, we had 5 active wildfires within our watersheds. 2 of these, Cameron Peak and East Troublesome, are the largest wildfires in the history of Colorado. While we are in the early stages of the wildfire response, it was a success to rally stakeholders to begin the recovery process. We are grateful for the relationships that we've built over many years and that are proving to be absolutely critical to the wildfire recovery. On the West Slope, a large group of stakeholders is collaborating to coordinate post-fire recovery efforts and organize the response. Northern Water is actively engaged in this group and coordinating much of the recovery response as it relates to watersheds and natural resources aspects. We're also partnering with East Slope stakeholders involved in the Cameron Peak recovery process, such as the City of Fakans, the City of Greeley, Larimer County, and many other agencies and stakeholders that are participating. The East Troublesome fire has affected significant portions of critical watersheds upstream of our West Slope collection system. On the West Slope, the burn area is so extensive, it is expected that post-fire runoff will affect all water bodies associated with the Colorado Big Thompson Project. And that includes water quality impacts, sedimentation, and debris that might impact our infrastructure and operations. We're also concerned about the fire impacts on current initiatives that we have been involved with for many years around Three Lakes Water Quality, Grand Lake Clarity, and the Grand Lake Adaptive Management Program. Although impacts from the Cameron Peak fire will undoubtedly be significant for water users whose water supply depends on these watersheds, the impact on the CBT project directly is expected to be less significant due to the location of the burn area relative to our infrastructure. Assessments are currently being conducted by Rocky Mountain National Park and the Forest Service Burn Area Emergency Response Teams. We do not know the full scope yet, as the assessments have not been completed. Therefore, our recovery plans have not yet been fully formulated. Because there's now snow on the ground and we are entering winter, our ability to implement structural measures and get treatments on the ground will be limited. We're looking at installing debris booms and preparing for necessary infrastructure maintenance that will be needed once runoff begins. We remain committed to working with stakeholders as we navigate the recovery process and will communicate plans and progress as they become available. We've placed more emphasis on keeping aquatic nuisance species outside of our system. And this is a program that, again, we've been involved in for a number of years, but that is getting more established over time.
Aquatic nuisance species, and in particular zebra and quagga mussels, pose a really big ecological and financial threat to Colorado's waterways.
Here in Colorado, every individual boat coming in is inspected before it goes on. It is probably the most comprehensive program in the United States right now. The biggest things we check for is quagga mussels, zebra mussels, some milfoil, some kind of vegetation species as well. They're incredibly invasive. They clog up infrastructure. They get along shorelines. They attach to boats. They affect the fisheries. And once you get those in your system, they're almost impossible to get rid of. So the consequences for this in our system are extremely high. We don't allow any invasive species brought in. So we're really good about, you know, checking for those things, getting really detailed.
We at Northern Water have a responsibility to provide a reliable and high quality water for all of our participants. And preventing ANS from entering our waterways is one of the things that we can do to help protect our source water.
Between Horsetooth Reservoir and Carter Lake, we hire about 30 people a year. Horsetooth Reservoir is the third busiest reservoir in the state of Colorado for recreation. In a typical year, by mid-June, we inspect about 3,500 boats. This year, we inspected about 8,200 boats. Carter Lake is about the fifth busiest reservoir in the state. We get into everything. We get into the bilges, we get into anchor ropes, the live wells that they fish. We're particular about what kind of live bait they bring in. Thankfully, we only get a couple boats that actually we find mussels on. Like they came from the Great Lakes or they came from somewhere down Lake Powell area. There's very few. We might get one or two a year, but even when those come in, those boats have been out of the water for quite some time. And we make sure those get completely decontaminated before we put those on our reservoir. As you can imagine, to hire 30 inspectors or more and run this program 7 days a week, long hours, from April 1st to the end of November, that program just for Larimer County cost about $600,000 a year. We're very fortunate that we have the partners that we do. Northern Water, the Bureau of Reclamation, the State of Colorado, Larimer County, all contributing funds to make that happen. So we're really appreciative to have all that help we do so we can run the program we do.
There's a new initiative that we have engaged in this year. It is focused on the Kawanichi Valley. The Kawanichi Valley is upstream of Shadow Mountain Reservoir. It's where the Colorado River flows from Rocky Mountain National Park into Shadow Mountain Reservoir. There's been a loss of equilibrium between the local wildlife and the geomorphic processes that take place symbiotically between the ecosystem and the river. There's a large ungulate population that has expanded over the years. Moose and elk and deer. Moose were introduced in the 1970s in that area. They're non-native to Colorado and they're non-native to this area, but they're now very well established there, and they browse on willows, and they have pretty much decimated the riparian vegetation along the Colorado River in this valley. Beaver that used to inhabit this valley have been extirpated because they too rely on willows, and the loss of the beaver in the watershed has caused some significant changes to the way the river behaves. It's more channelized, it erodes more, beaver dams cause overbank floodings that create green areas that are beneficial in case of fires, for example. They create natural fire lines. If we could restore some of these dynamics, restore the riparian vegetation, allow for some of these natural ecosystem balances to come back into place, we'd have a healthier and more resilient watershed that would also be more resilient to drought. So this is a new initiative that just started. It's in planning phases that involves Rocky Mountain National Park and the town of Grand Lake, Green County River District, the Forest Service, and the Nature Conservancy. We're doing that informally so far, but eventually these relationships we hope will get formalized into a group that will provide oversight to this long-term effort. Another thing that is ongoing as part of our water quality program is ongoing monitoring of water quality in our system. We have very extensive monitoring programs that cover both sides of the continental divide.
We collect continuous temperature data, water temperature data. The collaborative program we've been involved in and have been leading for over 10 years now with a number of our stakeholders, municipalities along the Front Range, to collect data on what is commonly referred to as contaminants of emerging concerns. It's a very broad suite of contaminants. They include things like pharmaceuticals, personal care products, pesticides. We have 150 compounds that are included in this program and that are regularly sampled in our system. And so we have this very extensive baseline of information that allows us to make sure we protect this level of water quality. We also monitor macroinvertebrates, aquatic bugs. And the reason they're important is that they are kind of a foundational piece of the aquatic food web, and they are a good indicator of the health of the river. Collectively, our monitoring efforts, when you include our temperature monitoring program, our baseline water quality monitoring, and contaminants of emerging concern, we're probably spending in the vicinity of a couple $1 million annually. We don't just sit on these data. We analyze them on a regular basis. We report on them. This is information that we use to make decisions and to assess our activities and our projects. We make our data available on our website. Anybody can retrieve these data. We have a new data portal that was just deployed this year. It is important for Northern Water to be transparent about its activities and about the health of the watersheds and the rivers that our systems operate within.
We continue to look at ways that we can enhance the operations of our project, including the environmental friendliness of our project. One example of that are wildlife crossings that we did jointly with Boulder County and CPW this year.
So these three bridges are going to be on the St. Vrain Supply Canal in the Dow Flats area. Boulder County Open Space marked them out. That's where they think the elk and the deer are migrating to, so it'll help prevent them from getting caught in the canal.
Something that we wanted to do and sort of a dream of ours, but an expensive one. So this is from an embryo idea in October or November, and we've got actually a completed one. This section of the canal got good habitat on both sides for deer and elk and a lot of other things. And there's only three places to go across in about 2 miles. So they'll try to go across in other places, but if they get into this section, it's too fast for them and they can't get out.
This one that we set today is just right upstream of the Longmont turnout. We got this one and two others along this stretch of the canal. So we built them in the shop, did all the fab work and welding in the shop. Built the footers and everything for the bridge to set on, built that in the shop too, and hauled them out here. We set them first part of the week, and then we just set the bridge today. We got to put the decking on it.
We're overjoyed to actually try to get these in and then also help Northern foot the bill, because it's a lot of work and they're very professionally put together. We're going to start putting cameras up on all three of them to see the elk use and the deer use and the predator use. These crossings are for all the critters out here, so bobcats are going to use them, coyotes are going to use them.
One example of a project we did to further enhance the environmental aspects of our project was working with CBW to increase releases out of Shadow Mountain Reservoir at a point where they were doing some stocking of smaller species to allow better survival of those species in the long run.
This is our annual batch of Kokanee salmon that we stock in the river below Shadow Mountain Dam. They head down the river, find their way to Lake Granby. We stock 1 million fish every year, and we just do this once a year. This is the whole batch, 1 million fish all in one shot. We often will ask for alteration in operations to get more water coming down the river to shoot these fish down the river a little bit better, and that's what we were able to do today, and we're eternally grateful for that. It's a huge help.
CPW reached out. They were going to do some stocking of Kokanee salmon below Shadow Mountain in the river between Northern and Bureau of Reclamation. We made some operational changes, increased our reservoir elevations a little bit to try to bring a little more water in. It was a good joint effort between Northern Bureau and CPW to get everything lined up and scheduled and done in pretty short order.
And the purpose of stocking them here is that they head down the river, find their way to Lake Granby, grow up for 3 to 4 years and mature, and then they come back here. Being salmon, like any other salmon, they want to come back to where they were born. They weren't born here, but they come right back to the place that you stocked them. And so because we collect eggs here below Shadow Mountain Dam in the hatcheries, this is where we want them to return to once they're ready to spawn.